Hi there! Welcome to the first video in a series of videos where I'll be building an app using the Phoenix framework. Now, I'll be taking an idea from wireframe to production, and along the way, I'll be implementing things like CSCD and Phoenixy features like LiveView. I'll get authentication in there, and really, if there's something interesting, that I'll try and build it and try to fit it into the application as well. This video series is for those that are new to Phoenix and are looking at getting something built with Phoenix itself. And I know I'll be learning a bunch of things along the way. We'll definitely be making a bunch of mistakes, so I will share any corrections and any lessons I've learned in upcoming videos. And if there's anything that I missed, please leave it down in the comments below. And in this video, we are just going to get everything set up. So I'll go through the app that I want to build, share the idea, and then we'll get our Phoenix application all up and running. We'll implement Tailwind CSS and style our homepage. So let's dive into it. So the app that we are going to build today is a social media for puppies slash dogs. So the idea is you can find your favorite dog, create an account for your own dog, post like puppy updates and have people subscribe to those updates. In other words, like follow your dog. Eventually, I want to create like a way for shelters to be able to easily add their dogs and have a message system where people could also inquire about their, you know, adoptable dogs. Now, the ideas that we want to build that haven't really fully fleshed out, so this is all definitely going to change in the future, but there's like comments and updates. We want to be able to have a feed of dogs, so maybe a personalized feed, a way to autocomplete search, so we want to be able to search on all of the attributes, and then filters to help you search for the dogs you want to see, so this could be maybe like tags or something like that. And then you have the ideas of like following a pup, so getting notifications, updates of the pup, and then also chatting to the right people, so you can message people and then also be able to start like adopting a dog. So let's have a look at the wireframes. Now I've built four wireframes. We have desktop homepage not logged in. Then we also have a desktop homepage where we have logged in. We have the ability to add a pup and then to show all the pups. So having a look at the not logged in page, notice that we can submit a pup. We also have named our app Sniff Social, and that, you know, can definitely change in the future. I'm not entirely sure if that's the name we want to go with. We have search and we have the ability to see a list of puppies. And then when we do log in, so say you've logged in as a user, you have your little profile and a little drop down menu that shows some contextual actions. And then maybe we would be able to personalize this page. So if you're logged in, maybe you would see a search that's kind of like auto-completed with things that you've already searched for, like search history, or have puppies that are related to what you've followed. So lots of things that we could do with this page. And then if we come down to adding your pup, this is a pretty generic form. So you can add in pictures with your pup. You can, this will open up the file picker on your desktop. You can kind of see we can add name, breed, color, personality, which is really just a bunch of tags, and then a big description box where you can fill out the description of your pup. And then finally, this page with my pups is a little bit, I'm not entirely sure what I want to do with this, but right now it's like a list of all the pups that you own. So maybe this is really good for a shelter scenario where they have to manage a lot of pups. There will be some description, the puppy name, and then you can go and edit that dog. Now, I just want to point out that these are wireframes, so definitely prone to change and will probably evolve over time. But now that we've looked at this, let's switch over to our terminal and let's start building our app. So we are going to create a new Phoenix application called Sniff Social, which is the name of our app, and we are going to install some dependencies. Now, this is going to take a little while, so I'm going to cut and we'll come back once they're all done. Cool. So now that the installation is finished, Phoenix offers some steps to get us the rest of the way there. So we're going to follow those. We're going to change directory into our application, run mix.create, and that will create our database for us. And once that's done, we will run mix Phoenix server, which will start up our localhost server. And this server is going to be running on localhost 4000. If we switch over to the browser, I actually already have that site open, and we can see that we have a generic Phoenix boilerplate up and running. So switching back over to our terminal, let's close down our server and run some git commands just to get everything initialized so we have everything in source control. After we do that, we are going to get Tailwind installed. So to do that, we first need to change directory into assets. And if we have a look at the assets folder, we can see that it contains our CSS, JavaScript, our package JSON, which is what we kind of want to edit, and then also Webpack config. So Phoenix ships with Webpack 4 as its default for now. We're going to run this npm install, which I pulled from the Tailwind docs, and this is going to install a bunch of stuff. And I'm going to ignore the security vulnerabilities for now. Definitely want to address that sooner rather than later. But let's just address that in a future video. So let's go back to our top level folder where our Elixir code lives, and let's open up our code editor. So in VS Code, our package.json shows the packages that we just installed using npm install. You can see there's some changes in package lock and package.json. And we're gonna create a new file and we're gonna name that the post CSS config. And we'll paste in some configuration that again is pulled from the Tailwind docs. And once that is done, we are also going to create a new Tailwind config.js file as well. Now we can create this through npx tailwind init, but I like just doing this by hand. And then in this, we are also going to paste in some configuration code that's going to be copied from the Tailwind docs. Now, if we have a look at this purge array, we want to bring in the files that we want Tailwind to purge. Now, that's going to be under lib, sniff social web, and then it will be all the files in our templates folder. And if there's any other folders, we can also add them to this purge array. But right now, we are going to add a glob where anything that ends in EEX will be purged. And purging in Tailwind really means removing any unnecessary CSS from our stylesheet that isn't being defined in our application. So if we are only using a small subset of styles, we don't want to bring in the entire Tailwind CSS. We want to purge the unused classes. Now, we also want to load our post CSS through Webpack. So let's switch back to our assets directory and run our post CSS loader. We need to install the post CSS loader. So if we try installing this right now, it will actually fail because the latest version of PostCSS expects a newer version of Webpack 5, which isn't in this Phoenix, but will probably be updated in future Phoenix versions. So let's install an older version of PostCSS. We're going to specify PostCSS 4. And then we're also going to install post CSS import, which will allow us to use the at import statements in our CSS file. And if we open up our code again, we can see our package.json. We've installed post CSS import, post CSS loader with the right version number. And we can remove anything that's SAS related because we aren't using SAS anymore. So removing node SAS and SAS loader. And that is really all we need to do for the install. And in our Webpack config, we can replace SAS loader with a post CSS loader, and we should be good to go. From there, we are going to go to our CSS folder, rename app.scss to app.css because we aren't using SAS anymore. And then in our JavaScript folder, we'll also fix that import path in our app.js file to link to the right app.css file. And then in our CSS file, we are going to remove all of this code and we are going to import our Tailwind directives here, or add these Tailwind directives, which will import our Tailwind styles. Now, from there, we are going to remove this phoenix.css file because we aren't using that anymore. And we are getting really close to getting Tailwind working. So had to jump through a lot of hoops, but let's start our Phoenix server and see what is happening. So let's start our Phoenix server again. We're going to run mix phoenix.server. I don't see any errors in the output, so that's a great start. And if we go back to our page, we can see that some of the Tailwind styles have now been brought in. And we can go ahead and test that Tailwind is actually working. So going back to our code editor, we can open up our template file, and that is found under lib, sniff social web, templates, layout, and app.html EEX. Now, if you're coming from something like Ruby on Rails, then this is pretty similar to the application.html.erb. And in our app.html file, we are just going to add a Tailwind class, bgred100, reloading this page, we can see that, hey, this actually made our background red, and we can kind of confirm that the Tailwind classes are actually being imported. Now, we can also open up our dev tools and look at our app CSS source to actually check that the Tailwind styles exist. And hey, it's there, and this file is huge, and it's also importing just some classes we don't even use. So Tailwind 2.1 has actually released a JIT compiler preview mode, which actually brings down this CSS file size to something much more manageable. So we can go to our Tailwind config.js and enable it here using mode JIT. This will automatically reload our server. And then heading over to our page again, we can see that this CSS file is much, much smaller. And the Tailwind JIT compiler will actually add your CSS during runtime, which is awesome. And you can tell from this file that we aren't bringing in every single style. We actually are only bringing in the classes that we will be using in our app. So now that we have Tailwind installed, let's get rid of this homepage text. And we'll copy and paste in some HTML that I wrote earlier. And this HTML just defines our homepage, and it has a bunch of Tailwind classes attached to it. It doesn't do anything too crazy right now. I'm actually just going to replace who's the goodest pup with our app name Sniff Social, and I'll move that line who's the goodest pup to kind of the subtitle. And this page will have a form that isn't really attached to anything. And also has some placeholder puppy pictures from a website called Place Puppy, which has some adorable pictures on there, so go check that out. And yeah, so really nothing too crazy on this page. So if we save this page and reload, we can see that all our HTML elements show up on this, which is great. We see the form populated. And then if we go ahead and try to change this form, there's actually an issue here. So reloading this page, there's no blue class. So that's super strange, because I thought we had Tailwind JIT installed. So what's going on here? If we go to webpackconfig.js, this .concat line is actually causing one of the issues. To fix this, we are going to paste in this exclude module plugin and add in the post-CSS loader as the module to exclude. This means that every time we save, our CSS files are actually rebuilt and they're not cached by that library. Now let's stop the server and restart it. But before we just pass in mixphoenix server, we also want to pass in node amp equals development. Because without this flag, Tailwind JIT will just compile everything once, but we want it to compile after every file rebuild. So let's reload everything, and we can see that, hey, the blue background is there. If we change this to green, this has reloaded, which is great. We can change it to purple as well, and hey, cool, all the styles are being updated using JIT. But there is one issue here. Phoenix and Webpack can get into a race condition, so let's comment out this code, because we just want to avoid any caching race condition that might happen, especially with Tailwind JIT. So restarting everything, then we can see that everything loads fine, and if we change our class from purple, maybe we do 300, still loads fine, and if we change this back to gray, everything is hunky-dory. Cool. So the next thing that we want to deal with is this kind of ugly header. We don't really need the Phoenix framework logo anymore. So hopping over to our app.html.eex file, let's just remove the header. While we're here, we might as well remove the background as well. And once I've removed that, I'm going to add some extra classes to the container to make the centering look good. And that's it. We are all done.
So let's do a recap on what we just did today. So we built a Phoenix application using some generators like phoenix.new. We also got everything up and running, and then we added Tailwind CSS to our project. This meant that we can just call all the Tailwind styles and it will just appear magically. We also turned on the preview JIT mode for Tailwind, which meant that our local styles sheet is much, much smaller. Instead of this huge thing that pulls in every single class, it's now only pulling in the classes that we use in our application. So all very fun stuff. Oh, and then we added some puppy pictures and styled our homepage. So in the next episode, I really want to get into deployment, because I think that's the fastest, or at least the best loop that I can think of, is you make a change locally, you push it to GitHub, and then you see that change appear in production environment. So that's what I'll be working on next video. And if you like this video, please give it a thumbs up. And if you have any thoughts about the name or any thoughts about future topics, please leave it down in the comments below. Until next time, see you later.